I heard your complaints about the pictures being too small. So I got a bigger picture frame. It's a little bit bigger than I expected, but I also moved. So I'm gonna give the updates at the end of this video because now is not the time, because today is the Devonian period. About 400 million years ago, life on this planet was getting bigger than it ever had before. This was the Devonian period, which lasted from 419 to 359 million years ago. Plants were getting upgrades that would shoot them into the sky. Predatory animals were getting to sizes that would send chills down your spine today. Vertebrates were conquering the no-bone zone.
Hey, the ocean is boring and I want to try something new.
Read my lips, it's a no-bone zone!
And of course, like every period we've covered so far, there were also some animals that were just weird as fuck. I'm gonna introduce you to a little sample plate of all of this and tell you the disrespectful way this period came to an end. My name is Lindsay Nicole. And this is the history of life on Earth that we know of. As always, we're gonna get the global conditions out of the way. This is gonna look fucking sick now. During this time, supercontinent Gondwana was finally headed north, away from the South Pole and ready to see other parts of the world, taking a nice little loop, like the Royal Caribbean Ultimate World Cruise. And finally, Gondwana had a buddy, another supercontinent right near the equator called Euramerica, which was formed by parts of, you guessed it, Europe and America, and also Greenland and Russia. Plate tectonics, as always, going absolutely nuts. Now that land plants are kind of doing their thing, I feel like it makes a lot more sense for me to introduce what the fuck they got going on at the beginning of the video to kind of set the scene. Probably should have been doing that the whole time, to be honest. Makes more sense for the flow of the video, but what are you gonna do? Okay, so in the Silurian, we had those vascular plants that were starting to evolve that Joey talked about, Cooksonia and whatnot, the shag carpeting on the riverbanks. And then, of course, the massive fungal towers that early invertebrates called home, like Prototaxites. But during the Devonian, the plants started to spread out beyond the wetlands, and Prototaxites got booted. They got replaced with the next major development in terrestrial plant life, the first large trees and forests. Yeah. Shit was kicking. This is the time plants started to get more comfortable with more rigid support structures that we know today as wood, which was great for early land animals who had found home in the fungus. Luckily, bitches love wood.
That's what she said.
Now you might be thinking, Lindsay, you said these were the first large trees in forests, but really, how big were they? They couldn't have possibly been that large so soon after the first development of wood. Well, I like where your head's at, and I can almost guarantee that there were lots of, if not mostly, pipsqueak trees. But the two that I know about, the more well-known trees of the time, were actually fucking massive. How do I pronounce that?
Wadiza.
The first one is called Wadiza and is known as the world's first tree that we know of. It got to about 30 feet tall and kind of looks like a palm. And the next one, Archaeopteryx, not to be confused with Archaeopteryx, the transitional dinosaur bird. I know they sound fucking identical. Archaeopteryx, the tree, was one of the first true trees with that classic woody trunk. And they could get to like 80 feet high that we know of, which is fucking insane. Both of these trees use spores to reproduce instead of seeds, because seeds were not a thing yet. Spores are what algae, fungus, and ferns use to reproduce today. It's kind of like the OG reproduction method of fungus and plants. Seeds do seem to have evolved during this time though, with the first gymnosperms. Let me make sure I pronounce that right, because I always get plant shit wrong.
Gymnosperms.
Got it.
Got it!
That's all the plant stuff I have for you right now. If you have any questions about other plants or wood, don't ask me. I need an in-house botanist because I am out of my comfort zone talking about plants. I am hanging on by a thread. So let's move on to something I'm more comfortable with, the animals. You might've seen this fish in a variety of meme formats. We've arrived at this time in Earth's history. This is Tiktaalik, considered the true transitional fossil, considered the first true transitional fossil between fish and water, and tetrapods on land that would eventually evolve into amphibians, reptiles, birds, fish. Not fish. Why did I write that? That's ridiculous. Mammals, us. That's the list. The Devonian land was finally getting its vertebrates. It was the end of the no-bone zone.
Do not compare my exoskeleton with your fucking bone!
Before I get ahead of myself, let me get some general information out of the way. Again, I want to define tetrapod. Tetra, four, pod, legs. All the vertebrates on land have four limbs, or legs, or at least had. If you remember in the last episode, I talked about the development of ray-finned fish and lobe-finned fish. The lobe fins holding those prerequisites that their tetrapod descendants would use to haul themselves onto land. The common ancestor of both the rays and the lobes had these things called air bladders connected to their throat that we now know in fish today to be the swim bladder. Helps with buoyancy control. The ancestors to tetrapods went a different route though. Their air bladders evolved into lungs. It might be weird to try and imagine what this would look like in a fish. A fish with lungs, lungs in a fish. But luckily we have a living fossil example of what this looks like. Lungs in a fish. One of the tetrapod lineages lineage's closest living relatives, the, you guessed it, lungfish, which have gills but also have lungs to breathe air, which they absolutely need to survive. They can live in dried up patches of mud and haul themselves onto land to get to a different piece of mud if they need to. And they go about it in a pretty grotesque way. And the ancestors to tetrapods probably started moving onto land in a similar fashion about 390 million years ago, that we know of. And with more and more time spent from shallow water onto land, came more and more adaptations to be comfortable there. At first, their skulls became flatter, with their eyes situated on the top of their head to spot food and foe from above the waterline in their shallow environments. They also got a neck for range of motion to look around. And of course, over time, their limbs became stronger and stronger to let them move around land with ease, since clearly getting around like a lungfish is not the ideal terrestrial form. The coolest part about this transition is all of the transitional fossils that scientists have found that literally show a gradient of characteristics from water to land. Tiktaalik is the most famous of those because it was kind of the missing link for a long time. And the story of its discovery is absolutely insane. So I actually decided I'm gonna make it a separate video that I'm gonna put out next week because it honestly deserves its own spotlight. I remember learning about this discovery in college and having one of those moments of like, holy fuck, science is so cool. One of the discoverers of Tiktaalik, Neil Shubin, has a couple videos on YouTube where he was either interviewed or giving a presentation, just talking about the discovery. And he is so just clearly passionate about it. And it's so cool to watch. So I'll link one in the description if you want to hear about the discovery from the first person point of view before I present it next week in the third person point of view. Over the years that I've been on TikTok, I've gotten tagged in a disturbing amount of anti-evolution videos that are trying to discredit this transition. Like, yes, TikTok is filled with garbage. But the sad thing is they're getting all of their information from these sources that they think are credible that I've never heard of because I'm not on the anti-science side of the internet, but they have sources for them. And that's true with anything, any topic, just with how search engine algorithms work, kind of keeps people in their own bubble regardless of if it's true or not. And that's really scary. That's why I started using Ground News. It's a website and app created by a former NASA engineer with a mission to help you read the news in a more objective, data-driven way. You can check out headlines from over 50,000 news sources from across the political spectrum and get a quick visual breakdown of each story's political bias, factuality, and who owns the source. It's all backed by ratings from three independent news monitoring organizations, so it is serious and organized stuff. Let me show you how it works using this story on lizard smugglers that got caught in Australia. Hell yeah. So you can see all the coverage details in the upper right corner, covered by over 50 sources, and more than half the sources covering it are politically centered. And then if you go further down to the bias distribution, you can see a visual of the sources that covered it and where they fall on the political spectrum. And you can click one of them and it takes you right to their article. According to the chart, 26% of the sources lean left and 11% lean right. If I scroll further down, we can see the factuality rating of the sources reporting and also who owns these sources. Let's compare real headlines between the two sides. Here's the Independent, leaning left. Australian police bust crime gang illegally exporting lizards hidden in chip packets and handbags, which focuses on the inhumane containers the lizards were kept in. Origo, which leans right, hundreds of exotic animals wanted to be smuggled out of Australia. Crazy language. If this was a story that popped up on TikTok, it's easy to misinterpret what the actual story contains because of how the headlines are being framed. So I've been really enjoying the ease of checking my sources with Ground News. Ground News also has this cool feature called Blind Spot that highlights specific stories that are mostly or only being talked about on one side, like this story about how Mr. Bean is being blamed for the lack of electric vehicle sales in the UK. Apparently, he has talked shit about electric cars. 60% of the news outlets covering this lean right, not so much on the left. In a world of misinformation and sides completely divided, it's more important now than ever to see the full picture, which is exactly what Ground News helps me to do. It gives me the tools to see the credibility of each story and how it's been rewritten, which is crucial for having a grounded perspective. If you want to get on this too, check out the link in my description, ground.news/LindsayNicole. You can subscribe through my link to get 30% off unlimited access to the platform, i.e. the Vantage subscription, which is only $5 a month. That's a plan I've been using, and it's a game changer with all the tools you have access to. Subscribing really helps the platform. It makes a huge difference in trying to make the news more transparent. Thank you, Ground News, for sponsoring this video. Now onto the animals that no one on either side really has any smack to talk about. So I actually don't have much to say about the arthropods that made it to land in the last period, which is shocking, because in the next period, they are fucking taking flight, and they are massive, and it is complex and huge and massive. So it's thought that flight in insects, and also insects in general, must have evolved during the the Devonian, or even earlier. But trying to find evidence of that is like trying to find the tiniest needle in the largest haystack in the world. They may be the most successful lineage today, but they are very small and weak as shit. There was at one time a fossil that was thought to be the oldest fossil insect, called Rhinonatha, discovered in 1919 as a little tiny partial head with preserved mouth parts, found in rocks about 400 million years old. It seemed to be an insect based on those mouth parts, and later specimens found from the same site had even more of their body preserved, and they seemed to be some sort of wingless insect, such as today's springtail looking thing. And so for a long time, this was considered the earliest insect ever found. But then, over 100 years after its discovery in 2017, the specimens were reanalyzed to be some sort of myriapod, the group that includes centipedes and millipedes, and we already knew they were bopping around, so now we got nothing that I know of. For now, this is just to say, prepare yourself for the massive leap that is coming in the next period. In summary, there were millipedes, and then money, for millions of years, and then boom, 3-foot-long dragonflies. Next, moving on to the trilobites. They were still kicking. That's all there is to them. But I promise the rest of this period was not so mellow. Like I said, there were still some specimens that were weird as fuck. There's always strange specimens for a variety of reasons. Maybe they look like aliens. Maybe they're bigger than you're comfortable with. Maybe they're just simply heinous. Luckily, the strange specimens on today's lineup hit all of these. And to really build the suspense, we're gonna get bigger and bigger as the video goes on. So, starting off with the smallest on our list, how do I pronounce this? My metaster. Let's just go with that, huh? Couldn't find anything, so let's just go with that. Allow me to introduce you to my metaster, which kind of looks like some sort of crab spider on a bad acid trip. This was, you guessed it, an arthropod that could get to about 5 to 6 centimeters long. So, just a little guy, but heinous nonetheless. Remember from the Cambrian episode, there was an arthropod that kind of looked like this, Morella? Well, they're actually considered to be related to each other. You can probably think of my metaster as like Morella's Wario, but they had a lot more going on than that. Since they were first described in 1931, my metaster's fossils have almost always been found in association with either a sponge or little cone cephalopods. They also seem to have lived in little groups. They were very social. Very popular. They valued friendship and helping thy neighbor. It seems as though sponges used them as a hard substrate to settle on. And the little cephalopods, I don't know, maybe they were just hanging out. So, even though my metaster looks like sudden death visuals, they seem to have been pretty chill little guys. All right, the next little guy on our lineup got to about 10 centimeters long, so still teeny weeny. It's called Schinderhans. I think that's how you pronounce it. Another arthropod that was named after the 18th century German bandit, cause yeah, I can definitely see the resemblance here. Right off the bat, I'm sure you're thinking it looks right out of the Cambrian, even more so than the last one. What is it about them that makes them look like a Cambrian creature? In the paper that announced its discovery, scientists mention it's the prominent limb, or claw, at the front of their head that makes them look like a Cambrian creature, which they call the great appendage.
That's what she said. Don't you dare.
I can already smell the comments coming about this one. A lot of Cambrian arthropods had the great appendage, like Opabinia, Anomalocaris, etc. And then boom, here's another one from 100 million years after that. At the time of its discovery in like 2009, this was a really big deal. It was thought the great appendage forms went extinct at the end of the Cambrian. It's still a big deal, but since then, Myrrhetherin was found, discovered from the Ordovician, so there's just a better understanding now that the great appendage did not disappear, as some had thought, and lived longer than we could have ever imagined. All right, we're gonna jump up quite a bit from 10 centimeters to 6 feet long. I know that's a bit jarring. Another arthropod in a heinous form we're already familiar with, the Cutoramus, a sea scorpion that was found in oceans that are now North America, the Czech Republic, and possibly Australia. Australia is unconfirmed for now, but it would fit right into the brand. The Cutoramus was one of the major predators of its time, with massive claws to rip their prey to shreds. Early overestimated calculations placed them as the largest sea scorpion to ever exist, until 2007, when a fossil claw of one of their relatives left them in the dust. Finally, we have arrived at the sea scorpion I've been waiting to talk about for 6 months.
My time has come.
Gecalopterus, the largest sea scorpion to ever exist, that we know of. Based on body size calculations from that 2007 claw, they could get to 8 to 9 feet long, dude. That's the length of 36 average scorpions today in a single file line. We don't have shit like Gecalopterus nowadays. So just how big was this claw that changed everything? The preserved length was about 14 inches, just over a foot long, but it gotten kind of chipped over the millions of years that it spent in the rock, so we're missing about a quarter of its length. So in life, it would have been 18 inches long.
That's what he said, right, guys?
And then scientists used the cross-multiply shit that we've talked about before to figure out a good estimate of their total size. You know, comparing proportions to their confirmed relatives and whatnot. Why exactly they got so big is not totally understood. And before you say oxygen,
stop! You violated the law.
I must stop you right there. That only applies to the giant insects and other related arthropods in the Carboniferous, which I have hinted at probably an annoying amount of times at this point. And yes, sea scorpions were arthropods, but they were not terrestrial arthropods during the Carboniferous. We're not there yet. We'll get to that in the next episode. So, Gigalopterus and other sea scorpion size is still a bit of a mystery. It's thought that Gigalopterus lived in fresh water rather than the ocean. So, more of a lake scorpion than a sea scorpion, if you will. Which honestly kind of makes it more heinous. I don't know. In my opinion, that's worse. Lake animals freak me out way more than ocean animals. Like the fucking giant catfish dude. Holy shit. Lake horror movies are much more scarier than ocean horror movies, and I am willing to die on that hill. It's the murky water, I think. I don't like the murky water. It freaks me out. Okay, so Gigalopterus probably felt like the end of the strange specimens. Kind of wrapping up the video. But if you look at the time left, that is definitely not the case. We are nowhere near the end, actually. Which means, yes, they are gonna get even bigger. And speaking of creepy, large freshwater fish, all of the rest of the animals on this lineup are fish. Yeah, the fish are finally starting to take over in fresh and salt water. So let me introduce you to the next strange specimen on our lineup, Hyneria. A giant freshwater fish that got to nearly 10 feet long. Like some of the more primitive species in the vertebrate transition to land, Hyneria had extremely powerful fins, which has led to some ideas that they were somehow able to haul their massive bodies on the land, but that's a big reach. They most likely use them to navigate the shallow and murky waters of their habitat. I personally don't like the idea of a large fish, 10 foot large fish, navigating shallow and murky waters. If you're more uncomfortable with the ocean creatures, you are gonna love the rest of this lineup. First, Titanichthys. They exceeded 15 feet in length and potentially got to 30 feet long. They were found in shallow seas all over the world and were placoderms. Remember the group of armored fish. Luckily, like most giant ocean vertebrates today, it seems as though Titanichthys was more of a passive feeder. In 2020, scientists tested the resilience of their jaws using something called finite element analysis, essentially applying virtual force to their jaws to see if they would break or bend, see how strong they are. Turns out they were weak as shit, which means they were much less likely to be active hunters, which need strong jaws to crush and smash their prey. Nope. Not Titanichthys. Their jaws would have cracked under the pressure. Their results were closer to those of basking sharks, which just hold their mouths open and let small food particles make their way in. Little things such as little shrimps and planktons. They also had really small orbits, i.e. beady eyes, which aren't great for active hunting either. But not all big things from this time were so passive. And this last one on our list, the biggest guy, is an absolute terror. One of the most recognized animals from the Paleozoic, the poster child of the Devonian period. And so for this prehistoric celebrity, I decided to team up with someone who has completely brought him to life. Julian Johnson-Mortimer, a world-renowned visual effects artist who has had his animations of the prehistoric world go viral on countless occasions. You might recognize his Leviathan animation or one of his many viral Spinosaurus clips. And I found him by coming across some of his animations of the next guy on our list. I've been following his work for a while now, and dude, these animations send chills down your spine. So I was stoked he was down to help me out with this part of the video. So without further ado, allow me to introduce you to the Dunk. Full name, Dunkleosteus. One of the first vertebrate super predators and the largest predator of its time, with lengths of over 30 feet. Commonly cited in scientific papers. What made this fish a complete nightmare was its armored head. Yes, another placoderm, but juiced the fuck up. And they had extremely powerful self-sharpening jaw bones as teeth. This apex predator was able to take down anything it could get its fangs around. And based on biomechanics studies, they were able to open their jaw within a fraction of a second, creating a vacuum effect that sucked prey right into its mouth. I know these fossils look fake and ridiculous, but this is what you get fossilized from a fish that had armor in its head. And actually, nothing else. The rest of the body is a mystery. You've got this tank of a head and nothing else, at least for now. And this has captivated scientists since the Dunk was first discovered in the 1800s. Their massive size has been based on comparisons and calculations and math equations and what have you. So now, I have a confession to make. The newest and seemingly most precise estimates of how big they got make everything that I just said about their size a lie.
You really think someone would do that? Just go on the internet and tell lies?
Yes. I deceived you. Just a year ago, a paper was published with new estimates of the Dunk's size, based on new and surprisingly, like scarily surprisingly accurate estimation methods. And they shrunk the Dunk. Absolutely obliterated it. You might be thinking, Lindsay, why would you do this? Why would you lead me astray? I wanted to make sure that regardless of how much you knew or didn't know about the Devonian and Dunkleosteus before this video, even if you had never heard of the Dunk, nothing at all, you would be able to feel the crushing weight of this disappointment from this paper, at least to some extent. How does it feel? I bet it feels like shit, doesn't it? All right, let's do a rundown of the paper, which if you're like me, you're probably going into it like, How compelling can a single paper be to disrupt a previous scientific understanding so drastically? Pretty fucking compelling, as you will see. It was published by PhD student Russell Engelman from Case Western Reserve University. He argued that the traditional methods of estimating the dunk's body size were shit, because they were mostly based off the body size ratios of the dunk's much smaller relatives, like Coxosteus, who has more well-preserved remains. And yes, quite a funny little name. But get this, there's also a Dickosteus that looks like this. Coxosteus was like 15 inches long, max, much smaller than the Dunkleosteus. So Russell was like, it's insane to take the ratios of small little guys and just scale them up and assume that's the big guy. There's no reason to assume it works that way or is accurate at all. Okay, so he identified the problem, but what about the solution? Well, Russell ended up coming up with a body size estimate equation method that seems to not only work really well for Dunkleosteus and its relatives, but also for most, if not all, other fish, which is insane. It's called the orbit opercular length, or OOL. I'm gonna call it the OOL. It's the length from the front of the eye socket, or orbit, to the back of the head. He showed, by applying this measuring tool to literally thousands of fish, that the OOL can really accurately predict the length of the rest of the fish. It showed that short, stout fishes tend to have short, stout heads, and long, slender fish tend to have long, slender heads. And luckily for us, the dunk's tank of a head can be accurately measured to determine the OOL. And the OOL is much shorter than you would expect based on reconstructions. And using the OOL, Russell estimated the dunk's actual body length to be somewhere between 10 to 12 feet long. Slap! And so likely shaped like a modern day tuna. Double slap! A catastrophe of disrespect to the highest order, all written out in mathematical models. And guess what else? This applied to Titanichthys too. A punch to the stomach, and probably Hyneria, because why the fuck not?
I'm tired, boss.
Russell Engelman dumped a jar of marbles onto the floor of the prehistoric fish department, and a vat of oil as well. As disappointing as it is to hear that Dunkleosteus is now Chunkleosteus, Russell's new model is a huge deal. Being able to accurately predict the sizes of literally almost every fish is gonna be huge for paleontology. It's a big deal for fishes everywhere. So I'm excited to see who else gets wrecked with this model in the future. There's another wreckage I have to tell you about that happened in the Devonian, and that is the end of it, the late Devonian extinction. The second of the big five mass extinctions in the history of animals that we know of. It lasted for about 25 million years and wiped out 70% of all species on the planet, mostly affecting marine life through different periods of global cooling and anoxia and etc., or reduced oxygen in the oceans. Marine life was getting slapped around like a ping pong ball, and many species couldn't keep up. Fossil evidence suggests there were up to 10 distinct extinction events that each had a unique impact on different ecosystems, and each had different causes. Just bad luck after bad luck after bad luck. One of the periods of reduced oxygen could have been due to volcanic activity, which also could have led to a global cooling. There was also an asteroid that seems to have pummeled into Earth at some point during this time as well. A nearby supernova is thought to have flashed UV radiation into a hole in the ozone layer based on evidence of some weirdly formed plant spores that seem to have DNA damage. There's also some scientists putting the blame on plants again. Their new developments and land takeover led to some atmospheric changes. Long story short is, the last 25 million years of the Devonian was a clusterfuck. But luckily, some species made it out alive and evolved into some more familiar forms coming in the next period, like amphibians and sharks, and some weird as fuck specimens that are gonna blow your mind. So stay tuned for that in the Carboniferous episode. So instead of the usual Q&A that we've been doing at the end of these episodes, I'm gonna give you some updates, because there are big updates. So, as I mentioned, new board. So before, I had a whiteboard. This is not a whiteboard. This is a frame. And before I filmed, I had to take out the glass piece because it was reflecting too bad. So this is just a bare bones frame. I'm planning to put some green screen in the back. I have the roll of green screen in the closet. Yeah. So I'm gonna, this is like green screen adhesive tape that I guess should work. I don't really know anything about green screen. This is mostly used for like kids' classrooms, I think, but we're gonna see. We're gonna tape this all up so then I can walk right here and the picture's still behind me, and that's gonna be fucking sick. But this is really exciting because not only is this a new backdrop, I also moved. So I am now in a designated office space. I was able to get a place where I can have my own office space. I don't have to move the couch out from the wall. I'm so relieved. It's so nice. It's already so nice. This is my first video here and it's so nice. I also got some acoustic panels. I'm gonna put acoustic panels up on the walls. I haven't done that yet. I haven't decorated really. So I'm gonna give you a tour once I decorate, but I don't wanna show you a half finished product. Well, I guess this whole video was a half finished product because I gotta put stuff up here, but you gotta do what you gotta do. So, I'm very excited because I'm already feeling a lot more comfortable filming here. If you've kept up with this whole journey, you know that my last place, like, the sound echoed through the hallways like crazy, and that just made me so, not nervous, but, and not really anxious, just, like, very aware of the fact that my voice was just, like, echoing through the halls, and I hated it. I don't want to, like, bug people like that, you know? So I feel like I was talking, like I wasn't entirely comfortable, and now I feel a lot more comfortable. The lighting and the sound is just already better in here. It's insulated even without the acoustic panels. So I'm gonna start getting back into short videos. I've been uploading some ones that I made like a year ago. I'm gonna try to start making more skits again. I really miss doing those. But yeah, that's the update for now. I'm gonna give you a tour when it's all decorated and everything. I hope you're excited. If you know anything about green screen and what I'm about to do is very obviously not gonna work, please let me know. Here's what I'm concerned about. There's gonna be like an overlap line, and I don't know if that's gonna affect it. I don't think it will. I hope it doesn't. I hope that doesn't like mess up the image, you know? But if there's anything crucial that I need to know that you know, please let me know in the comments. Other than that, if you like this video, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss my breakdown of the discovery of TikTok coming out next week. Check out my Patreon for behind the scenes updates and our Discord server. And for now, stay curious. The world has a lot for us to learn. See ya!